Hello students, today we are in the last lecture of chapter 3 of the book Indian Economic Development. Till now we have done in this chapter deficiencies in Indian economy during 1950 to 1990, introduction of new economic policy 1991, privatization, liberalization and globalization. In our last lecture we started the concept of World Trade Organization. Now, some important points about WTO are as follows. WTO was founded in January 1995. Before WTO came into existence, the organization was GATT, G-A-T-T, General Agreement on Trade and Tariffs. But WTO has a far wider scope than GATT. Because GATT includes trade only in goods, but WTO covers trade in services also. GATT was established in 1948 with 23 countries only, but today 157 countries are the members of WTO. WTO is a full-fledged international organization. Here all issues are decided by voting and each nation has one vote. The representatives of the members and all officials of the WTO enjoy international privileges, amenities and benefits. Now the question comes in our mind that what does WTO do? What are the functions of WTO? Actually, it aims at enlarging production and trade of services to ensure optimum utilization of world's resources. It provides platform for trade negotiations among its member countries, which are 157 in number. WTO handles trade disputes between its member countries through dispute settlement body. WTO monitors national trade policies. WTO provides technical assistance and training to developing countries. It cooperates with International Monetary Fund and International Bank for Reconstruction and Development. WTO helps in providing greater market reach to all its member countries as it provides equal opportunities to all countries in the international market. India, being an important member of WTO, has been in framing fair global rules and is obtaining opportunities and benefits out of it. Students, we were discussing the functions of WTO. As we know that WTO is a measure towards globalization, we should also know here that this globalization offers significant opportunities for India, which follows as under. India has the opportunity to become the prime production center of the world. This has already been grasped by the Asian tigers like Korea, Hong Kong, Singapore, Taiwan, Thailand, Malaysia, Philippines, etc. in the 80s. But now this opportunity is available to India and China on a much bigger scale. India, like Latin America, Eastern Europe, Russia and China, wants to attract foreign investments. We have to make efforts for a share of potential investments. Here it is ironic that the new foreign investment in India is only a fraction of what China has been able to attract. It is significant for Indian corporations to go into international markets and to become India's multinationals abroad with markets and later production centers spread all over the world. After discussing all the three economic reforms towards improvement and development of the economy, now it is the time to analyze the impact of all the three reforms together on the development of the Indian economy. These three reforms, L, P, G, have both positive and negative impact on our economy. It is a fact worth noting that the mounting burden of borrowings, both domestic and foreign, brought the Indian economy to the stage of insolvency in early 1991. the most visible sign of the country's economic crisis was its extremely low foreign exchange reserves. The rapidly growing burden of national debt, which was 60% of the gross national product in 1991. There is no doubt that due to economic reforms, the economic situation has now changed as compared to what it was in June 1991. On the external front, exports are growing. Import growth has lagged behind. Both trade deficit and balance of payments, current account deficits, have considerably been brought to be under control and reasonably reduced. The rupee has become strong currency now. So, let's discuss first the positive impacts of these three reforms on Indian economy. First positive impact is that growth of an economy is measured in terms of its GDP, gross domestic product, and no doubt our GDP rate has increased at around 8.5% during this reform period. Second positive impact, that during the reform period, it was noticed that growth rate of about 8.5% is mainly due to structural changes, means shifting of contribution from primary sector to secondary and tertiary sector, and especially it was by growth in service sector. Third positive impact, that in post-reform period, both foreign direct investment and foreign institutional investment have increased, which was a serious problem before the reforms. Our foreign exchange reserves have also increased from $6 billion in 1990-91 to $297.3 in 2010-11. Students, you will be surprised to know that today India is the 7th largest foreign exchange reserve holder in the world. Due to reforms, India is now seen as a successful exporter of auto parts, engineering goods, IT software and textiles, etc. It is remarkable. Due to LPG policies, inflation is brought under control. The annual rate of inflation reduced from nearly 16.7% in 91 to around 7.5% in 2012-13. Fiscal deficit, which adversely affected the Indian economy prior to 1991, now started recovering after the economic reforms. Prior to 1991, the outflow of foreign exchange was more than its inflow. But due to introduction of LPG policies, the deficit in BOP, current account, has reduced significantly. Where one side the positive impacts were remarkable, on the other hand, there were also some negative impacts of these economic reforms. And negative impacts are as follows. Firstly, though the GDP growth rate has increased in the reform period, still there are not sufficient employment opportunities in the country. It shows economic growth during reform period, but without creating adequate employment opportunities. It happened because public sector started retrenchment of workers because of their low performance and overstaffing, and also the private sector terminated employees because of modernization and technological advancement. So, both these sectors, public and private sector, contributes to unemployment. Second negative impact, that industrial growth has also recorded a slowdown because due to globalization, our economy was open to greater flow of goods and services from developed countries. Cheaper imports replaced the demand for domestic goods. The disinvestment process was also not of much success because assets of public sector were undervalued and sold to the private sector. This created substantial loss to the government. Also, the proceeds from disinvestment were used to offset the shortage of government revenues rather than using it for the development of the country. Next negative impact is that fiscal policies were not effective as tax incentives provided to foreign investors to attract foreign investment. It reduced the scope for raising tax revenues. Tariff reduction also reduced the scope of generating revenues through custom duties. Globalization has widened the economic disparities among nations and people. Very important adverse effect of economic reforms LPG was faced by our dominant sector, our primary sector, that is agriculture. Reforms did not benefit the agriculture sector due to many reasons, like Indian farmers had to face increased international competition due to increased import. Removal of fertilizer subsidy increased the cost of production, which severely affected the small and marginal farmers. There was more focus on the production of cash crops instead of production of food grains, which resulted in the price of food grains. Public investment in agriculture infrastructure like irrigation, power, roads, etc. has been reduced in the reform period. The failure to raise the rates of domestic savings and investment. One more negative impact is the failure to attain the goals of monetary and price stability, as also those of correcting the central government's fiscal imbalances. The most important one is the deterioration in health and educational standards. Basically, we did reforms in 5 sectors: in industrial sector, financial sector, tax sector, foreign exchange sector and the trade sector. But in our new economic policy, we did not concentrate on health and educational standards. In India, health and educational standard is very low comparatively to developed countries. Thus, from the entire above discussion, we can conclude that the economic reforms which were started in 1991 as new economic policy resulted in the growth of only some selected areas in the service sector, like information technology, finance, travel, hospitality, etc., rather than vital sectors such as agriculture and industry. So, students, our chapter has been completed here. Now it is the time to check our understanding of this chapter. Let's do few multiple choice questions to test our knowledge. Question number 1. WTO has been established in option 1, 1980, option 2, 1991, option 3, 1995 and option 4, 1990. You have to tell in which year WTO was established. Yes, the answer is 1995. Second question. How many industries are compulsorily required to take license for establishing a unit? Option 1, 3, option 2, 6, option 3, 10, option 4, 8. Compulsorily required license. These are 6 industries: alcohol, cigarettes, hazardous chemicals, electronic aerospace, defense equipment, industrial explosive, drugs and pharmaceuticals. Question number 3. How many entities are reserved for public sector? Option 1, 2, option 2, 3, option 3, 4 and option 4, 5. How many entities are reserved for public sector? Yes, the answer is 3. Because atomic energy, railway transport and those substances which are notified by the government of India are reserved for public sector. Question 4. Process of integrating our economy with the world economy is known as option A, privatization, option B, liberalization, option C, globalization and option D, economic reforms. Answer is globalization. Question number 5. Dash is known as excess of public expenditure over public revenue. Option A, budget deficit, option B, fiscal deficit, option C, primary deficit, option D, capital deficit. The answer is B, fiscal deficit. Question number 6. Dash is a systematic record of all the economic transactions between one country and rest of the world. Option A, balance of trade. Option B, balance of transactions. Option C, budget. And option D, balance of payments. My question is, DASH is a systematic record of all the economic transactions between one country and rest of the world. Yes, the answer is balance of payments. Question number 7, which institution helps in motivating globalization? Option A, GATT, G-A-T-T. Option B, IMF. Option C, IBRD. And option D, WTO. Yes, it is none other than WTO. Question number 8. DASH refers to removal of previous government restrictions. Liberalization, privatization, disinvestment or globalization. Yes, it is liberalization. So, students, this chapter is completed here with these questions. We will meet again with many more topics of your book. Thank you.